questions for the candidates were submitted online by voters. I'm Linda Rogers, forum moderator, and a member of the League of Women Voters in Anoka, Blaine, Coon Rapids area, sponsor of this forum. I live in Anoka and cannot vote for any of these candidates. The goal of our forums is to help citizens become informed voters. The League of Women Voters does not support or oppose political parties, does not support or oppose candidates for office. These candidates care very much for whom you vote, but the League doesn't. The League's goal is that each of you will vote. Candidates for House District 32B are Alex Small and Matt Norris. All candidates for this race were invited to participate in the forum, and all two candidates agreed to participate. Welcome, Alex Small and Matt Norris. We'll begin with two general questions that were provided to the candidates in advance. This will be followed by questions from the public that were submitted online. Candidates will rotate answering first, and I have asked them to please correct me if I make an error in guiding the rotation. We'll end with closing statements from each candidate. Candidates will have up to 90 seconds to answer each of the first two questions. So let's begin. Alex Moe, what is your motivation to run for this office, and what experience or knowledge would help you serve effectively?
So my name is Alex Moe. I'm running for Minnesota House of Representatives for 32B. And what motivated me to run for office is, I guess it comes down to, at what point do you stop complaining about what's going on in your state and do you actually do something about it? You know, there's been a lot of things that have happened in recent years, especially these last 2 years, that both me, my family, and the people in my community have not been very happy with. And so when I saw that, I decided it was right for me to get involved and to do something about it rather than just complaining about it or saying that this is so ridiculous. And so that's why I decided to run, was to be a young voice for people who's going to be a public servant and not a politician, somebody who's truly going to represent what is best for Blaine and Lexington, as well as Minnesota as a whole. So that's what really motivated me. You know, I've always had a streak of serving the public, whether it be through Boy Scouts, through schools, through my community, through my church. I've always wanted to serve others, and I think this is a great way to serve others and make a real impact in my community.
What is your motivation to run for this office, and what experience or knowledge would help you serve effectively?
Well, I'm a look-in for almost 20 years now. My work has been focused on working with and for the community to identify problems and solve them. It started in my hometown when residents were concerned about rising youth crime. So I spearheaded an effort and reduced violent crime by 40% over a five-year period. Then, during the pandemic, we discovered that high school students and senior citizens on Social Security were being left out of our state's unemployment insurance system. So I got to work and took on, even at times, the administration of my own party to get the issue fixed and the outdated and unfair 1939 law repealed to make sure those citizens of our state had access to unemployment insurance benefits, just like everybody else. And then in 2022, I stepped forward and ran for the Minnesota House of Representatives, vowing to finally get the funding needed to fix Highway 65. I was proud to lead the effort that's contributed $103 million to fully fund the project and remove four stoplights here in Blaine. Now, there are always more challenges on the horizon, more ways to make life better for Minnesotans. I believe my decades of work, working to solve problems with and for the community, is the type of leadership needed for this role. I want to help my community thrive and do right by my district and my state.
Matt Norris, what are your goals for 32B's future?
My top priority, if I'm re-elected to the Minnesota House of Representatives, is to make life more affordable for Minnesotans. In particular, I want to focus on what I call the three cares: child care, health care, and senior care. All three of these are such big budget items for a lot of Minnesota families. If we can reduce the cost of these big budget items, it leaves more room for gas and groceries, those other things that are harder for us to control in the first term, I authored 84 bills. And I'm really proud of the fact that of those bills that I co-authors, about two-thirds of them had support from both Democrats and Republicans. I never imagined I'd author as many bills as I did. For reference, my predecessor, only I think authored 8 in his first term. But I like being a problem solver. So when community members and other key stakeholders came to me, I got to work, and I was able to get 34 of those bills passed into law. So while my top priority is making life more affordable for Minnesotans by focusing on those three cares, I commit to once again listening to you, the voters of Blaine and Lexington, to respond to the issues that are most important.
So, when it comes down to the goals for 32B, and this reflects for the whole state, but obviously it's very important for Blaine and Lexington as well, I want to help reduce costs and fight inflation for my fellow citizens, help improve law enforcement, help improve education, and help our working class. So, when it comes to costs and inflation, this last 2 years we've seen a gross increase in the amount of taxes and the spending of our government. We've seen government spending increase by 40%, and we've seen $10 billion in new taxes added to businesses and individuals, and even the ones added to businesses are going to be passed on to the individuals. This goes from everything from property to gas to sales tax. All across the board, we've seen costs increase, and when we're fighting record inflation, that is not how we can help our citizens actually afford things and get through this. Can't afford, I've had citizens at the door tell me they can't afford groceries, gas, basic essentials, let alone anything extra. If they wanted to have a little bit of fun, they can't afford the bare essentials. When it comes to law enforcement, again, we've seen very poor things these last 2 years in the legislature. We have 1,000 officers missing across the state. That's 10% of our police force. That is a problem that is only getting worse, and we need to address it now before it becomes a problem. We can't stop. Lastly, when it comes to education, we need to address the fact that about 50% of people in the Anoka Edwin School District cannot read at grade level.
Thank you, candidates. I'll now ask questions submitted by the public. Responses for these questions are limited to 1 minute. Alex Moe, would you support the Silver Alert public notification system for seniors? And if it were put into place, what outcomes, positive or negative, would you expect?
So I will say I'm not 100% familiar with the Silver Alert system. My assumption is it's something to do with seniors who need medical attention of some kind. I would obviously support doing what we can to take care of our senior citizens. You know, they worked for many years to take care of us. They paid their fair share of taxes. They've made our communities to what they are today. And so it seems only fair and only right that we take care of them as best we can. I can't say for certain whether I'd support it overall because I'm not familiar with exactly what that is, but I would say that I would give it my utmost attention and make sure that whatever it is something that is in the best interest of our citizens.
And Norris, would you support the Silver Alert public notification system for seniors? And if it were put into place, what outcomes, positive or negative, would you expect?
Yes, I do support the Silver Alert system. As we have an aging population here, we're saying we're going to have to adjust to make sure that we are accommodating a growing senior population in Minnesota. The Amber Alert system has been very effective in terms of abductions, and I think the Silver Alert system is just a natural progression in terms of using the infrastructure that's already been built to make sure that our seniors are being cared for appropriately as well. I also, overall, have really been focused on that transition to what we call the silver tsunami, that aging population here in our state. I spearheaded the effort to eliminate the tax on Social Security benefits for the vast majority of Minnesota seniors. I also know a lot of seniors are worried about staying in their homes, especially because of things like rising property taxes. So I actually authored and passed 2 property tax cuts at the state level to help our seniors stay in their homes as well.
Do you support a Minnesota Equal Rights Amendment? Why or why not?
Yes, I do support an equal rights emphasize and understand is this notion of freedom and making sure that everybody is respected, no matter their background, their gender, their race, whatever it might be. And I think that Equal Rights Amendment is an important way to do that. It's also an important way in Minnesota to make sure that we're protecting reproductive rights. This is something that I'm really alarmed when I see what's going on in other states like Texas. I think it's important to underscore that abortion is health care. And unfortunately, we're seeing access to that, sometimes even life-saving care, being denied in other states because doctors are worried about being punished by the state. If you are a woman out there and you're wondering who is in the best position to make your own healthcare decisions, and you feel your best position rather than the two men sitting up here, I am your candidate.
Alex Small, do you support a Minnesota Equal Rights Amendment? Why or why not?
So first of all, I think it's always important to say that all people, regardless of their race, ethnicity, background, anything about them, all people deserve equal rights. And those rights are actually enshrined in our Constitution of the United States. All people have those equal rights. From what we have been given by the Constitution and subsequent amendments, all people are treated equally, and they should be. When it comes to the issue of abortion, there's two sides to this argument. There's the people who, on the one hand, we believe that we should ban abortion completely with no exceptions, and then that's one extreme. On the other extreme, there's people that say that abortion should be allowed up until birth for anyone. That's another extreme, and that's the extreme that my opponent voted for in the Minnesota legislature. In Minnesota, right now, you can get an abortion up until birth with no exceptions, and you can even come from another state and get an abortion, and it's going to be paid for by the taxpayer dollars. Most Americans, most Minnesotans specifically, don't support either of these two extremes. So I think it's important we bring things back to not being either of these extremes, and that's what I would support in the legislature.
Alex Small, a high number of active duty military, National Guard men and National Guard women, and veterans live in the Blaine and Lexington area. What experience or insights do you have regarding the military and making sure that veterans are well cared for?
So this one's actually very important to me. My sister actually was in the Army Reserves, and she got Lyme's disease at basic training. So when she was in basic training, she had a tick that later turned out to have Lyme's disease. When she tried to talk to a commanding officer about it to say that she thought there was a problem, she was refused to see anybody until a month or so later. They're like, oh, we got Lyme's disease. I guess they have this permanent illness for the rest of your life. So for me, it is very important that we are taking care of our veterans, whether they went across seas and served or whether they served locally. Regardless, our veterans deserve the utmost and the most respect, and they deserve to be treated with the best care we can give them. When it comes to VA benefits, I had a great conversation with one of my constituents about how we need to make sure that the VA is giving them the best possible benefits and that we're making it as accessible and as easy as possible for these veterans to access these services and also give them as much variety as we possibly can.
And Norris, a high number of active duty military, National Guard men and National Guard women, and veterans live in the Blaine and Lexington areas. What experience or insights do you have regarding the military and making sure veterans are well cared for?
One of the greatest honors of my first 2 years in the legislature was being appointed to the House Veterans and Military Affairs Committee. And through that role, I've been able to really important work to help the men and women of the military in our state. I carried the House Veterans and Military Affairs policy bill on behalf of the Minnesota House here in 2024. I also authored legislation that renewed and expanded the Helmets to Hard Hats program that helps active duty and retired military transition to careers in the construction trades. I've also had the opportunity to travel the state and visit important military installations around our state, like Camp Ripley, the 148th Fighter Wing up in Duluth. And so you can continue to count on me to be a champion for our military and National Guard.
Ben Norris,
that Minnesota has traditionally provided aid to both cities and counties. For cities, it's called local government aid, or LGA. For counties, it's called county program aid, or CPA. When I took office, those programs, LGA and CPA, were still at 2003 levels. Think about how much the cost of everything has gone up over the past 20 years, and they were still trying to get by on the same level of funding from the state as 2 years or 2 decades ago. And as a result, our cities and our counties are having to raise property taxes, because that's the primary way, other than this local government aid and county program aid, that they fund local government. So my colleagues and I said, we're going to use part of that surplus. Alex mentioned this surplus earlier. This is a really tangible way we use it. We significantly bumped up this local government aid, which in turn makes sure that your local government entities have the funding they need and reduces the property tax bill.
What is your view on Minnesota aid to local governments? What are the pros and cons?
So I think things like local aid can have their places where it can be positive and it can be negative. I think the best way to ensure we can utilize this program successfully is to make sure we are keeping track of what happens with these programs. In the last couple of years, we've seen record amounts of fraud at the state level when it comes to the fear of future, when it comes to frontline workers' pay, and when it comes to the unemployment during COVID. We saw over $1 billion in fraud. Now, this comes because of government mismanagement of these programs. So all of the things like local aid are very important and very helpful to our local communities. We need to make sure that we are doing so in a way that we are actually keeping track of what's being done with the funds and making sure that they give you a proposal of what it is going to be used for, and that it is then actually used for that purpose, and it is used as cost-effectively as possible to make sure we're using taxpayer dollars responsibly and in a way that is actually going to best help our citizens.
PFAS, forever chemicals, have been linked to cancer and have been found in drinking water across Minnesota, including in Blaine. How will you address this discovery?
You know, I think things like that, we've heard a lot of things, I think, in the news about things like forever chemicals, microplastics, a lot of things that end up in your drinking supply that tend to not be very good, whether they be causing cancer or other illnesses. So I think it's important for us to really take things like this seriously, make sure we're doing the proper tests to see where the levels are at, try to understand where it's coming from. Is it coming from dumping in lakes or streams? Is it coming from things that are being put in the ground and then biodegrading? We need to understand what those things are coming from. And I think the first step would obviously be to take a survey and to do some studies to figure out exactly where and how much of those things there are. And then we'll go from there to figure out what steps can be best taken that are cost effective and efficient to address this issue and try to limit or remove any PFA, PSS, or any microplastics or any other chemicals in our drinking supply or any of our bodies of water.
Norris, PFAs, forever chemicals, have been linked to cancer and have been found in drinking water across Minnesota, including Minnesota. How will you address this discovery?
I think this is a perfect example of where experience matters, because we don't need any more studies. We know exactly where this stuff comes from. It's time to start taking action. That's exactly what my colleagues and I did at the Capitol. I offered a bill that eliminated the use of eliminated PFAS from firefighting foam. Studying how do we remove it from the turnout gear that our firefighters wear, so making sure we're protecting our heroes from exposure to these chemicals. We also passed the strongest non-essential use ban for PFAS in any state in the country. These things are in dental floss, tampons, everyday products, and we said, no, unless there's absolutely no substitute, we need to phase out the use of these cancer-causing chemicals. Problem, and this is where your vote matters, is there are big corporations that really hate this law that we passed, and unfortunately the other side decided to side with them. So I will stand up and say no to those big corporations. You can't continue to polluting, you can't continue to poison our people, poison our people, and unfortunately the other side has not stood up to them.
Recently, there have been news stories about aquifers and the challenges governments face to maintain them, including monitoring, usage,
institutions that are responsible for making sure that we're protecting our drinking water, that are making sure that big corporations aren't illegally tapping into our aquifers and sucking out more water than they're supposed to be. And so I am somebody who will stand up for protecting those institutions rather than attacking them, trying to make you believe that all these institutions are failing us with the goal of making sure that those institutions aren't there to protect you from big corporations, from big banks that are trying to, you know, be, you know, irresponsible things with your money, from big corporations that are risking our environment by putting pollutants into our air, into our water.
Alex Small, recently there have been news stories about aquifers and the challenges governmental units face to maintain them, including monitoring, usage, and disconnected oversight agencies. What can the legislature do to protect aquifers?
I think a big thing that we can do is make sure that any of these agencies that are in charge of this, for one, obviously we need to give them the resources they need to properly monitor this, because this is one of the things that government pays good for. You know, there's a lot of examples of government overreach, but things like protecting our aquifers, our environments, there's certain things they can do that makes sense for them to do. So in an instance like this, overusage, things like corporations overusing, whether it be corporations or individuals who are abusing their aquifers and their water sources, we need to make sure that we're addressing that. We also need to make sure that we're not doing so in a way that's preventing people from actually using these water sources. There's a fine line between over-protecting and just making sure we keep our environment clean and safe.
Alex Small, do you support or oppose requiring criminal background checks on every gun sale? Please explain.
You know, I believe that as it currently stands, we do require some amount of background checks for every gun sale. You know, I've purchased a firearm before. I know many other people have purchased firearms before. We don't just give them out to criminals. We don't just give them out to anybody who asks. But I think a good example of where we do need to be stronger on is straw purchasing, where somebody would buy a gun for somebody else, so somebody who has a clean background, buy a gun for somebody who probably wouldn't have been allowed to get a gun. These are things that we can do to actually crack down on illegal gun ownership or guns that are going to be used in future crimes. We need to be focusing on making sure guns stay out of the hands of criminals rather than trying to make it so unnecessarily complicated for a legal law-abiding citizen to get a gun.
Norris, do you support or oppose requiring criminal background checks on every gun sale? Please explain.
I do. I support the second. I believe in the right for people to responsibly own firearms, but no right is absolute. And one of the common sense regulations that can also save lives and is also broadly supported by the public is making sure that everybody who buys a gun has a background check done. Sure that they are not a danger to themselves or others. I mean, they've got, by voting in favor of universal background checks, as Alex mentioned, they actually now are a law in Minnesota because of the action by colleagues that I took. The mentioned straw purchasers were actually one step ahead of it, Peter. We passed a bill this year that is going to cut down on straw purchases. Unfortunately, we saw a straw purchaser purchase or acquired through a straw purchase that was used against law enforcement down in Burnsville here in Indiana. So it was a tragic situation, and that's why my colleagues and I took the steps we did to make sure we're protecting all Minnesotans, but especially law enforcement.
And Norris, last session, a bill was introduced in the House, House File 1930. It would have allowed terminally ill adults to request a prescription for life-ending medication, which they would have to self-administer. Ultimately, the bill was not included in the omnibus of the bill. What are your thoughts on the bill?
It's a great question. This is actually an ongoing dialogue that I've been having with my constituents here in Blaine and Lexington. And I mentioned before that I really take seriously hearing from the voters. And this is one where we have been having a really positive dialogue about it. We have some very strong advocates who believe that it should be people's freedom to decide if they are mentally competent and they are terminally ill, that they should be able to have the choice to concerns about, and they have concerns about, you know, does it expand to include other individuals in the future? They have concerns about, you know, is it truly a choice, or is their hand being forced by the cost of health care in our country, which is a whole other debate that I'd like to get into at some point. So at this point, I am committed to continuing to listen. I'm not trying to dodge the question. I seriously have not made up my mind on this particular one yet, so I look forward to continuing to dialogue with the voters and my colleagues on this.
Alex, last session, a bill was introduced to the House, House File 1930. It would have allowed terminally ill adults to request a prescription for life-ending medication, which they would have to self-administer. Ultimately, the bill was not included in the omnibus health bill. What are your thoughts on the bill?
Sure, so, like Matt said, it's a very complicated issue, and it's one that has been a more recent development, and it hasn't been something that's been talked about for years on end. And it really is a very complicated issue. I've talked to some constituents, I've talked to some family members, some other community members, and there's a lot to unpack here. On the one hand, like Matt had mentioned, some people may feel that this is the best option for them, you know, ending their life rather than racking up medical bills and burdening their family in some way or another, whereas others might not be comfortable with the idea of somebody essentially taking their own life. And there's a lot of other factors, including who prescribes this medication, that the theoretically the doctor, are they violating their Hippocratic oath of doing no harm by doing something? It's a very complex issue, so I also have not decided one way or the other whether this would be something I would support or not. It's something that I believe we need a lot more conversations and discussions on to really get to the bottom of whether this is the right solution or not.
We have time for just one more question. Alex Small. Currently, many hospital beds are filled by people who do not belong in a hospital, but are there because of staff shortages in nursing homes. What steps do you recommend to create an ample skilled workforce in nursing homes?
I mean, there's a couple different things we can do here. One would be to try to support people trying to go into this profession, just like law enforcement, where we have a massive shortage right now. We should try to pass bills that support these industries that are experiencing these shortages and try to bring more workers to this industry, try to bring more workers into this field to try to address that shortage. Obviously, that's a little bit more of a long-term solution, since I think we would have to go all the way through their training programs. And in the short term, I think just trying to make sure that we are making Minnesota a place where people want to stay. I've heard of a lot of people in the healthcare industry, law enforcement, teaching, say that they are leaving Minnesota because it's unaffordable. You know, we have the highest corporate tax rate. Top five individual tax rates in the country. When people see that, they don't think Minnesota's affordable. They'd rather move to some other state. They don't feel like they're appreciated. They'd rather move somewhere else where they feel like their degree will serve them better and their experience will serve them better. So these are things we need to address if we want to keep skilled workers in Minnesota.
Matt Norris, currently many hospital beds are filled.
My campaign is focused on a central theme of building bridges and getting results. I've been able to accomplish big things in my first 2 years. $103 million for Highway 65, $300 million in public safety and for our city security, property investments, increased funding for our schools, all while being in the top three for bipartisan bills. But we still have more work to do. We need to make life more affordable for all Minnesotans, like I talked about, especially with the three cares. We need to make sure that all of our students are succeeding in our schools. We need to make sure that we're keeping our neighborhoods safe. You have to choose who is best positioned to address these challenges. I believe I have proven that I am a problem solver who has the experience needed to deliver those big results and do it in bipartisan fashion. I think that's what the voters of Blaine and Lexington are looking for, and I would be honored to be heard on your phone.
Alex Small, your closing statement.
I think, if anything, in these last 2 years, what we've really seen is that we need a change in Minnesota. In this last session, we had a 1,400-page omnibus bill passed in the last 45 minutes of session. That doesn't scream unity to me. That doesn't scream collaboration. And it was along party lines that bill was passed. That doesn't tell me that people are working across the aisle and trying to actually do what's best for Minnesotans. Because when that bill was passed, and they actually passed the law, there were no physical copies available, and there were no digital copies available. How can we, in good conscience, be passing laws in the best interest of our constituents when we don't know exactly what we're voting for? And how can we be transparent in doing what's in the best interest of our voters when they can't even understand what was actually voted for? I'm running because I want to renew your trust in Minnesota and in Minnesota's legislature, and we can do that by electing somebody who has real-world experience. For me, I've worked in the schools, I've been a school representative from both law school, undergrad, and elementary K-12 school. I was the state school representative for my school. I've worked in those union jobs, those working class jobs, corrections, food industry, manufacturing. I've had jobs from all these different industries. So not only do I know what they're thinking, I've been there, I've done that, I know how they're feeling, not because I heard stories or because I looked at research data, but because I actually talked to them and worked right alongside them. I have the experience, I think, that we need to see if we want to see unity in Minnesota and see people actually working together for the betterment of Blaine, Lexington, and our state. That's why I'm asking for your vote.
League of Women Voters thanks the candidates for speaking to voters about issues and for running for Minnesota State House of Representatives, District 32B. Thanks, viewers, and those who submitted questions. Find links to all forums at lwvabcmn.org. General election is Tuesday, November 5th. Early voting starts September 20th. You can vote early at your city hall or Anoka County Elections Office. Please see your city's website for additional information. You can register to vote, update your registration, find information on voting options, and find your polling place online at mnvotes.org. mnvotes.org, or the Minnesota Secretary of State website. You can also register or update your registration at polling place on election day. So many options to vote. If you're interested in League of Women Voters, visit our website